I believe that the huge mistake was to ignore or actually to dilute the infamous red line and to let Assad stay in power after he used chemical weapons against his own people. Obama's decisions to retreat from Iraq, which was, I agree, was very popular after Bush's years, was a huge mistake because he has been dealing with a new situation. Whether we liked it or not what was done before in Iraq, in 2009, 2010, we had a new situation. It's like you reached a certain position at the chessboard. You probably had a bad plan, but you cannot, you know, regret about it too much going back saying, I would like to restore the status quo, because old status quo was dead. And while attacking Assad and removing him from power 2 years ago was a politically explosive decision, preserving him in power, you know, led to the dramatic consequences that we're seeing today.
What do you think President Putin may do next? I mean, what is your analysis of his strategy, and how do you think the West will respond?
I don't think we can call Putin's actions as a part of a strategy because it's, or you may call it a strategy of survival, because he has every successful dictator, you know, lives from, you know, day-to-day business. So 10 years ago, he looked for having friends, you know, to solidify his power in Russia. Right now, he's looking only for enemies. Putin's domestic agenda is very much based on his ability sort of to present himself as a victorious defender of great Russia everywhere in the world. So that's why I would expect him to move on to every soft spot on the global geopolitical map, Syria, Iraq, maybe next Benghazi. So there are many opportunities for Putin to create more chaos, because operating in the chaos always give a dictator a huge tactical advantage.
Why do you think that those outside Russia, who dislike some of the aspects of his rule as much as you do, haven't, as you would put it, been stronger in opposition to him?
Yeah, I'm quite puzzled by the statement, some of the aspects of his rule. I mean, after my friend and colleague Boris Nemtsov was gunned down in front of Kremlin, I think that's just speaking about, you know, any kind of, you know, opposition inside Russia or any, you know, any democratic process in Russia is just, it's almost insulting. I'm not surprised that people are just trying to avoid strong actions, because, I mean, it's quite natural. It's human nature. Speaking of diplomacy and engagement, you know, always makes you popular. The problem is that diplomacy and engagement brought us there. And Vladimir Putin or Iranian mullahs or North Korean dictators or other thugs and terrorists in the world, I mean, they are not equals. They're not negotiating in good faith. And pretending that we could have Khamenei, Assad and Putin at the table, at the negotiating table, and to reach a deal that they will respect, and this deal will end up conflicts, it's more than naive, you know. It's a huge mistake, because we could see that their interest is exactly opposite to ours. They need conflicts.
You mentioned your friend Boris Nemtsov a few moments ago, and Mr. Nemtsov advised you to leave Russia. You were living, I think, part of the time in Moscow, although with bodyguards and so on until 2013. He advised you to get out for your own safety. He stayed. Now, he published stories about the way that the Putin circle had enriched itself with the Sochi Olympics, and you referred to his murder. Do you believe straightforwardly that he was simply murdered by the regime?
Absolutely. I mean, it's suggesting otherwise, you know, simply ignores the nature of the regime. It's a mafia-like structure, and to go after someone like Boris Nemtsov, the former deputy prime minister, at one point Yeltsin's successor, the man who was well-known not only in Russia but around the world, without, you know, not maybe direct order from Putin, but like, you know, the him nodding to this silent request whether Boris Nemtsov should be eliminated. I think it's virtually impossible to imagine any other scenario. And Boris Nemtsov, you know, was a man of imposing presence, and the very fact that he could attack Putin, and it's not only on Sochi and many other things, was unbearable for the regime. And I could only wish that Nemtsov would follow his own advice and could have left Russia and now just be fighting with me alongside from outside of Russia.
At this juncture, 20 years and more since the end of the Cold War, and of course the end of the Soviet Union, how dangerous is the world in your view?
It's more dangerous than 20 years ago, definitely more dangerous than 10 years ago, but probably it's... it's a seasonal effect. We all were sharing the same optimism in early 90s. But history is not linear, you know. It probably goes in seasons. And now we are just entering this new dangerous season. And I believe, you know, I'm acting like an honest weatherman. So you should not criticize me for offering you an accurate forecast. We have to act decisively if we don't want this new winter, you know, just to be demanding on us.
Gary Kasparov in New York. Thank you very much.